Thank you for tuning in to TalkWad.com, the world's fastest growing internet radio network. Please check out all the other great shows on www.talkwad.com.
Hey, this is Straight Up with Toby Martini. I am Toby Martini. On this show, we're talking about business. We're talking about getting started, keeping it going, and making money, actually. If you're an entrepreneur or you want to be, this is definitely the show for you. So call in later today, and we will get this started. Hey, everybody. Toby Martini. How you doing today? Okay, all together now. Okay, no, I actually get no feedback. So let's see. Something that's interesting about today is I don't have a guest. I'm kind of used to having a guest. I like to have somebody to play off of, to ask questions, figure out where they were going. But the person I had kind of disappeared. I don't know what happened to him. So I hope everything's okay. Meanwhile, back in the forest, we're doing Straight Up with Toby Martini. So we talk about business stuff. And something I haven't really said enough is, and if you've been listening at all, then you know, but my angle is always your mental blocks, right? Things that get in your way from going out and just making millions and being really successful. And it's always about the little chatter in your head, the little voice that talks to you that says you can do something or you can't. And it's a weird little voice. It either thinks you're completely awesome or you completely suck. It's never really in the middle. But I love to talk about those aspects of your mind. Like, how does this work? And I think I said it when Kathy Potts was here a week or so ago, that the only reason everybody's not successful, the only reason is because of your own chatter in your head, your own little limitations that say, I can't do this part, I don't know how to do that part, or if I do this, people will think I'm insert whatever it is that you don't want to look like, you know? People think I look greedy, or I will look stupid, or I'll look goofy, I look manipulative, like whatever it is that is your thing, you really couldn't stand to be like. So it's really weird. And so the thing is to get connected to that voice. And I don't mean connect with it, like jive with it. I mean get to a place where you could always hear it. And then when you hear it, that's when you can go, oh, that's just the voice, right? Because if you don't actively hear it, if you don't get good at noticing when it stops you, then it just runs you. It just gets free rein to stop you, right? And so you get more familiar with, you say, oh, God, I don't want to do this thing today. I'm bored or I'm tired or whatever. All just, you know, mental states. And then you go, well, what's really behind that? Do I just not want to do it? And why? Why do I not want to do it? And then if you can figure out why, it's the thing that's, because you don't want to look some certain way or you don't want to try and fail. Again, same thing. Fear of failure is I don't want to look some way. I don't want to fail in front of people. People will think I'm whatever, I'm not smart. I'm not good, And then again, like we talked about before, people chunk up to, if you don't do something well, you immediately think you're a bad person on the whole. No, you just don't do that one thing well. Or you even just did it not so good this time. I have to say sorry to my unofficial sponsor, Mountain Dew. They are not with me today. Completely ran out of Mountain Dews. Now I'm sad. So I'm out of Mountain Dews and I'm out of guests. So today I'm just going to talk about some interesting brain stuff. Brain stuff. It sounds funny. It sounds small, but it's everything that happens here in your head, in your business. It just gets stalled by your brain. So I do want to say it's up on the screen for those of you who see video, but for those of you who are listening, you could call in, and today would be a great day to do that because I like to talk to people. Phone number is 813-235-0644. So 813-235-0644. And you can call in. We can talk about business. We can talk about communications, my favorite bit, or talk about mindset, something you've learned, some way to get through. Right? Something that stops you. One thing, if somebody had systems, I mentioned that a couple times. I'm just not systems guys. I always just want to wing it. I always just want to go, okay, it's going to work out for the best. We can do that. And it's a great attitude. It's helpful. It's good when somebody says, do you want to do this thing? Yeah, of course. Right? Yeah, let's go make that happen. So that's a good thing. But as you progress, you need to implement systems so you don't have to keep winging it again and again and again every time. So let's see. What do I want to talk about? A little bit today will be, and we could talk about like marketing. I had some ideas to talk about how do you get your concise message? Because I think that's a big thing, especially for people who go networking. You know, how do you say your pitch? Right? I kind of don't like calling it a pitch either. But we'll talk about why that is. So the thing is, people say you have an elevator pitch. And an elevator pitch, it started from when people were pitching startups. And again, they still do it. But you get the ear of, you know, of somebody who could fund you. And they hear a lot of them. They hear a lot of pitches. And so you want to know if you got in an elevator with, or you got in a small room with somebody who could potentially fund your startup, you need to be able to say what it is very fast. So they get the gist of what it is, who it's for, and how that could return money. The thing is, it's not exactly the same as what you would do at a networking event. So you go to a networking event, it's not about pitching your wares so somebody will give you money, not directly anyway. The idea when you go to a networking event is you want to share what you do and who your people are so that the other people in the networking event can recognize your audience when they see them. So if I tell you I do websites for coaches, then that is really narrow and it helps you. So when you're out and about and you go to another networking event and you see somebody who's life coach and they go, oh yeah, I still don't have my website up. Then you go, oh, I know a guy, because very clearly that guy does websites just for coaches. But it's not buy my stuff, right? It's not send me money. It's not write a check. It's about who are your people. And the other piece of it is really important when you're sharing your message. And, you know, I say this, especially, you know, an entrepreneur, somebody starting doing their own business. It is equally important for an employee, but you just have to pitch it a little differently. But the first thing to do is to get in touch with why you do your business, right? Why you do that, how you got into it. I did it. You know, often people start a business because they had a problem and they struggled with it and they figured out how to get through it. And they might have invented a widget or they might have developed a process or, you know, a service based on this thing that annoyed them so much or caused them some pain. And they figured it out and they get through it. And go, oh, this would be helpful for others. I know other people might need this. So now you can walk out and you know other people have that problem. And you go, look, I started this because I had such a problem with blah, 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 whatever it is. And now I've done this to fix that problem. Now my life is easier. And I think other people need that, especially if you know who that target is. And then if you can say it with some passion, with some real interest, some vigor, then the person you're talking to, whether or not they're your client or somebody who might be a partner or somebody who could refer for you, it's your passion for the thing that sells it, because people buy you before they buy your stuff. Two people selling the same thing, whatever it is, coaching again or pest control, keep using the same ones, but a lawyer even, you kind of want to like the person, right? If given two exact same sort of product or services, the person that you like more is going to get the business, right? That's why people say people do business with folks they know, like, and trust. So be you out loud. Show your personality really big and connect with people and share your passion. Say, I am in this because I love these people, right? Or I've had this problem and I know other people have the same problem. So that's the thing. And it helps you figure out your market too. Again and again, every single week, I'll tell you, you need a niche. You need a particular group of people who are your people. And I hope nobody minds I drink soda. Nobody's giving me a comment that says how annoying that is. So I'm going to continue to do it. All right. So your pitch, I mean, I make mine up every single time. And I go to a couple networking things every week. And I make up a new thing to say every single time. Now, you don't have to do that. But at least vary it a little. Or even if it's 80% the same, that's okay, I guess. But vary it a little for who's there, or at least just for auditory interest. Because if I said the exact same thing in the exact same way every week, people stop hearing it. It just kind of becomes wallpaper. And I do know people who say the exact same, you know, five lines is what they say about their business. And when you're sitting around and 20 people are going to talk, you actually don't really hear it anymore, I think. I don't know. I guess their argument is that you've heard it a lot and it gets ingrained in your head. So then when you do meet their target market, you remember their words exactly. And it's not vague for them. So I guess there is an argument, but I'd rather be interested every time. I'd rather every time somebody stood up and I can hear in their voice why they do their business, then that gets me enrolled. It gets me to like them. And I go, oh, yeah, he really is in that because he likes it. All right. So but you do have to be clear. And so the thing I would say to do is be clear on who the target is, who's your audience. So when it's time for me to refer, I know who is your people. But then also, what benefit is it, right? What do they get out of it? And again, not features. Nobody cares. It's 50 megs and it's got three USB ports and blah, blah, blah. I mean, they might care about that later, but really want to know, like Apple was the example when they came out with iPod. They weren't telling you gigs and megahertz. They said it holds 5,000 songs. You're like, oh, I know what that means. Everybody knows what that means. And it made it easy for folks to say, I need that thing because it holds music and it plays music. Okay, good. It's easy. It's real clear. So whatever your business is, what's the benefit? Who's the people and how do they benefit from it? And if you can tell me that, then I can refer people to you. It's real easy. And I have a little thing that says very clearly, I help specific target market, right? Get this benefit. And then you can say buy or how you do it. But not don't explain the whole thing, right? Not every step of your process. But so I help specific target market get benefit by this action. So I help people make more money. What kind of people, right? I help small business people get funded by showing them how to get their paperwork in line, right? And then how to become fundable at a bank. Oh, that's pretty clear. I get it, right? Your target market is a small business looking for capital. The benefit is you can help them get money quickly and easily, and you do that by being the intermediary between them and the bank. Oh, okay, that's cool. Next time I talk to any small business person who goes, yeah, I'm trying to get loans, but I can't get through the bank, I know a guy who helps people get themselves fundable. Looks really good. So, and I do know a guy. I know a couple of guys. If you need some funding and you're close or you can't quite figure out how to make that happen, you know, you can contact me. And I'll put you with somebody, the lender, okay? So that's, and if you think about that, you know, this is how you would put your business in a nutshell. I help specific people get this benefit by something, somehow. It's also something you could use to be more concise when you're talking about anything. And people say, even if you're an employee or I have such a hard time. I say that word, and it almost, at least in my ears, always has a little derogatory connotation to it. There's a little inflection about employee. I'm like, oof. Because I just don't get it anymore, you know? And it's okay, I guess, if you're an employee who's got freedom. But I guess I just have this real aversion to the whole cubicle world thing. So I had this guy who was going to be here today. Who, I don't know, I guess he's out there freelancing, but he's the kind of guy, he doesn't want to be in a cube. He doesn't want to be in a business. He doesn't want to do a 9-to-5, and he's casting about for various things. He's looking for mentors in a couple of different markets because he wants to get into that business, and I really wanted to have him in because it's my favorite step of this process is that somebody trying to figure out what can they do, right? And then what are the first couple of steps to take once I figured out which angle I'm going to go in? So you know, I've had a couple weeks, you know, people who've had some businesses, they've been going for a year or two or more, and they're moving, you know, they may or may not be millionaires or anything yet, but their businesses are kind of moving, you know. But I really like people who are new. I got a dream, I got an idea, or I just made my first two or four sales, or I made a couple hundred bucks a month. I'm going to help those people make a couple thousand a month and then 10,000 a month. That'd be the best. So we'll see what happened to this gent, and maybe we'll get him next time. Let's see. So marketing thing. I was at SCORE. I think I mentioned it before, the Service Corps of Retired Executives. It's a great organization. Locally, it's at scorepinellas.org. There's a Tampa version too. Don't know the address. I should probably look it up. But SCORE helps people in small business get organized to help you with your whatever aspect of business you're struggling with. How do I do advertising? Or, you know, how do I get a building? How do I buy a building? How do I get funded? Stuff like that. So they're good. But I was speaking at this event for them. And one of the questions was, what's the difference between marketing and sales? And it doesn't sound like a big deal. Sometimes people lump those together, and they're really different a little bit. And I did want to talk about that today. Let's see. Was I clear on the market, on the strategy, your pitch, your 30-second, your commercial? If all you tell people, and I'll go back to the marketing is good for sales. Target market, simple benefit, how you help, right? So people will understand real easily. Okay, cool. Just didn't feel like that was closed. So then what's the difference between marketing and sales? So sales is the process of, you know, trading money for something or even bartering. But trading money for a service or a product. And marketing is about making people aware that you have a thing for sale. Getting people to know about it is really the focus of marketing. And really good marketing actually helps make sales easy. And that's why I think marketing is the best piece of the whole thing. Good marketing makes all of it work better. As a quick aside, like my past, I was a software developer in a couple of big companies. And as a software developer, we actually hated the marketing people. This is before I became enlightened. We hated the marketing people because they would send us something that said, does our software do this? And we go, no, it doesn't. And they said, well, it needs to, because that's what we're selling. I'm like, well, what are you doing? You can't go out there and sell something we haven't built. It only takes you 1 minute to say it, but it takes us 6 months to make it. So developers will be mad at the marketing people, just because we'd be like, oh, God, they'll say anything to a customer, you know, to make it happen. We'll put stuff in ads in the salespeople, right? Because they'll just say, oh, sure, it can do that. And it seems easy. And so we get mad and just think they were terrible people. And it turns out that actually they were more right than we are, because we would develop software in a box. We're sitting in cubicles, literally thinking in the box. We're sitting here developing requirements for what we think people will need and the way that they should do it. The truth is the marketing people are out there talking to customers saying, what do you like about this? What don't you like about this? What would you like added? What would you like taken out? The customers, the people who actually will use it, the ones who will pay to have it, are the ones to, you know, asking for those features. So the marketing people are right. They're asking the customer, what do you want, as opposed to us just making it up, what we think they probably want. So, you know, marketing helps you figure out what your product would be. Marketing makes sales easier. Marketing is the only way that people get to know that you have some stuff. And so it is, how do you do that, right? So advertising is a piece of marketing. Speaking in public in any way that you can, or speaking in media. If you get an interview, get a press release, you're on TV, something like that, on the radio, hey, hi. All of that is just getting people to know your name, see your stuff. There's a couple other things. These are the biggest ones, especially advertising. Everybody knows about advertising, but advertising, I don't know. I don't know who it's good for. It's good for big companies, for sure. You know, Coke can spend $50 billion just to make sure next time you're thirsty, you buy a Coke. It doesn't always work. They don't know how it works. They've got enough money to just push it out and hope that it works, right? But for small business, you don't have that much money, I don't think. And when you do a marketing effort, you actually need a return pretty quick, right? If you spend $500 on something, you're probably expecting to make $1,000 or more back in the next week or two, or at least this month, right? Small business folks usually don't have that much money. They can just, you know, be on the radio, be on TV, be having vendor tables at events and all that stuff that costs thousands and thousands of dollars without knowing for sure it's bringing money back in really quick. And that's the difference between marketing in order to get a sale and marketing for branding's sake. And nobody, I don't think anybody making less than $1 million a year should be concerned that much about branding, right? And there's different aspects of what branding means. Just real quick, it's not just your colors and your logo, but it's mindshare. What does your name represent? Like, quick, what is Volvo? Right? Safety. That's their thing. That's their brand. Their brand is safety. It's not like whatever. They're blue, right? And their logo. So marketing is a thing that is getting people to know your stuff, right? And so in that case, they own the word safety. Hold on. The other way. Yay. Yeah. All right. Five. Talking to my production people. Hi, Brandon. How are you?
How you doing, man?
Hey, he's online. Hey, how you doing? I don't actually usually do that much, but I'm still not used to doing this radio thing, so yeah. I'm peeking through the window. He's giving me, you know, suggestions, and I forget that I'm on video for people to see, so I should do a little more of this. All right, Brandon, we're going to go to commercial in just a couple minutes. Let me say a word or two about marketing, and we'll talk again after. All right. So I want you to know that the thing about it is, if you have the best widget in the whole world, you have the best product in the whole world, if people don't know, they can't buy it, right? So you need to do marketing. And whether that's networking or, and again, advertising, I'm shy on. You know what I should do is have somebody who's in advertising come in and show us, you know, really tell me the value of advertising when you're a small, very small company, right? Because advertising doesn't seem like it has an immediate return, which is what most of us need. So marketing makes your sales easier. If you can say you capture the person who's your perfect target market and they're really enrolled and they go, yeah, they really understand me. You know, that guy gets my struggle. He understands. Either he's been through it or it sounds like he totally gets it. If they feel like you know them and you understand their pain or their problem, their issue, whatever it is they're getting through, they go, okay, cool. They really like you, right? The closer you can be to them, the better. And then here's the benefits of working with me. And it's not features. It's not, it does, again, the Apple thing, you know, it's 58 gigs of space. Most people don't know what that is, but it holds 5,000 songs. Cool. Right. So if you know the benefits of working with me, and then when it comes time to buy it, it's like, oh, well, I really like him. And it sounds like he knows what I'm talking, you know, my stuff. And I get those benefits. Those are great for me. So when it comes time for the sale, it doesn't require any pushy, salesy stuff. It's easier. It's just easier because they already feel identified, they feel connected to, and then you've got the thing that will fix it for them. So marketing makes sales easy. It's just a thing I have. I did a one day on it one day. One day. I did it one day. Me and Jimmy Leo, who's a local speaker, is a good guy. And we're talking about how marketing makes sales easy. How do you use that stuff? So a piece of it is most people don't like doing sales because they don't want to look like that salesperson, like a used car salesman or that kind of thing. Sorry, used car salesman, you're not all terrible, I'm sure. But if you have the people all primed and enrolled and liking your stuff before they even get there, you don't have to be pushy. You don't have to be salesy. You just have to connect with those people and be real. So we'll talk more. I will figure you can obviously talk. I don't have a script. I'm just I'm looking at some stuff I've used in the past. I'm a wing it kind of guy, especially today when I just have to talk at this microphone and not a person. So it's really weird for me. So I hope it's not too weird for you. If you are listening today, you know, it would be cool if you called, and you can call 813-235-0644. That would be cool, different, unique, and I can talk for an hour if people will go, yep, I see what you mean. That'd be better. So give me a call if you can. Brandon's out here somewhere. He's going to run a little commercial for us. I'm going to stretch my legs and have some more soda because it's good stuff. Okay, so we'll be back in a minute and a half or two at the most. Thank you very much. We have a minute. Oh, look, it's a Pepsi break. All right, so the unofficial sponsor for today is Pepsi. Even though I used Coca-Cola as my branding example earlier. I'm very unilateral. All right, we're going to go to commercial. I'll see you in a couple minutes.
The West Central Coast of Florida has an amazing music scene. Festivals, clubs, special performances, and there's always a lot of live music. The problem has always been getting the word out about events. Then GoTonight.com emerged on the scene. The brainstorm creation of founder Don McKeon, a Sarasota entrepreneur. We caught up with Don and his inspirational friend, Frank Papa, at the Flying Dog Cafe.
This is Frank. I'm Don. Frank is the reason that there is a GoTonight.com. He would call me repeatedly.
Where are we going? Where do you want to go? Where will we go tonight?
The website has been a boon to many small clubs. So next time you find yourself asking, where will we go tonight? You've got the answer.
Formed in 2008, Tampa Bay Birth Network was started by a small group of dedicated birth professionals. The Tampa Bay Birth Network's primary mission is to provide a community of professionals, families, and individuals who support, educate, and/or promote natural pregnancy, birth, and parenting. This year's Natural Birth and Baby Expo is sponsored by the TalkWide Network in association with Mama Bear Shares Talk Radio Show and will be broadcasted live from the Largo Cultural Center on April 6th. We'll be showcasing our local birth centers, midwives, childbirth educators, natural baby retailers, photographers, family health resources, and much, much more. You don't want to miss this one-of-a-kind event. If you're interested in becoming part of this year's Natural Birth and Baby Expo, please visit us at TampaBayBirthNetwork.org. That's TampaBayBirthNetwork.org.
All right. Hi, everybody. I am officially back. This has been kind of weird for me. I hope it's been weird for you, too. I think I said that on the way out. All right. So let's talk about something fun. I know what I want to talk about. Part of the thing, the other thing I talk about the most, that I talk about a lot the most, talk about networking. And there's a piece of networking that is kind of confusing for people. This part about most people know enough psychological personality tests and stuff like Myers-Briggs and DISC. They know that people are introverts or extroverts, right? And the thing is, we kind of have the common layman version of it is wrong. We think extroverts are very loud, talk to everybody, popular, famous, like that, or, you know, could be famous. Like, they're very loud, boisterous. And introverts are shy. Like, that's almost how it comes across. And it's not really true, right? Shy isn't – more people who are shy are introverts, but not everybody who's an introvert is shy by any stretch. All it means in Myers-Briggs especially is that extroverts think out loud. That's how they figure out what's in their head. They talk, and then they fix it as they go. You might be surprised to know I'm 100%, well, a 10 on a scale that goes negative 10 to 0, 0 to 10. I'm a 10 extrovert. I think 100% out loud, and that's in conversation. I figure out what I think and share. And then introverts think inside, this is a crazy thing to say, they think inside their heads. They figure out the answer before they ever open their mouth. And there's nothing wrong with either way, except in some situations, some do a little better, right? So extroverts have sort of taken over networking because we walk around and we talk to more people. And, you know, there's no the best way to network, but there's a couple of different tactics that people take, and some are E100, extroverts 100, and they go out and they, if there's 50 people in the room, they're guaranteed to meet 48 of those people. They're going to meet everybody and shake hands and say, hi, how you doing? And they're going to trade cards, and they're going to have really minimal conversations, a minute, two at the most. Most people fall in the middle, right? It's a curriculum. It's a bell curve. And what happens is people who are introverts, the sad thing is they often don't even go. They go, oh, I should network. I'm supposed to. But then when it comes time to go, they find 9 reasons not to go. Today is the only day I could possibly wash my dog, right? Just like we talked in earlier weeks about, you know, anything's better than doing my accounting. Anything's better than, for some people, going networking. So sadly, most of the introverts, they don't even go to the thing. And if they do go, they hang around the outskirts and they don't talk to a lot of people. But that's not the problem. You don't have to talk to everybody. Right. So the introverts, they don't really get into groups. They have a little snack, they eat a chicken wing, and they leave. And they say networking sucks. And if I was more extroverted, I would do better. And a lot of people, they will train themselves. They become a cultivated E. They train themselves even against their better nature, not better nature, but their innate nature of being an I. They train themselves to, you know, gird up and go talk to a lot of people. And the truth is, the introverts do have an advantage if they just play the game their way. And it's fine to go networking if there's 50 people there and you meet 2 or 3 in an hour, hour and a half. You meet 2 or 3 and talk to them for 20 minutes each, 20 minutes, half an hour. You really get to know them. You connect as a person, right, using your introvert style, which is, I will talk to somebody. It takes me a while to warm up, but once you get me going, I'm good. I'll get connected, right? That's an introvert way. So that's really good. The person or two who you talk to, they leave, they really like you. They feel like they got to know you. And the difference then is an extrovert will go to an event with 50 people and meet 30, collect a lot of business cards and follow up with, you know, of 30, they follow up with 20 and they make 2 sales down the road. The introvert person, maybe they only met 3 people, but they follow up with all 3, and maybe down the road they make 2 sales. Ultimately, it works out the same. You just play the game a little differently. All right, and so there's really nothing wrong. And I love my introverted entrepreneurs. I have a 1-day event that I'm actually going to be doing at the end of April. It's called Unstuck, Unleashed, Unstoppable. And it's for, literally, the introverted entrepreneur. If you've got a service, you have a product, which is really good, but you just don't know how to talk about it, don't know how to connect to people, don't know how to share, come to this event. I'll help you break that up a little bit. Hope that doesn't scare people. People get scared by break that up. Shy is, See, I just did the collapse of that too. Introvert doesn't mean shy, but, you know, in our society, it kind of looks like that. And shy isn't even really a thing, right? There's no physical shy. There's just a conversation in your head, and it's some way that you've acted for however many years since the one day you decided to be shy and something worked for you. And so you go, wow, it worked, and now I'll just be quiet about stuff and it'll keep me out of trouble. Well, it worked when you were 6. It doesn't work so much when you're 36 or 46, so you need to retrain that. So an introvert isn't necessarily shy. They're just better at coming up to a complete answer inside their head, and they would generally prefer to talk to one person for a very long time as opposed to 50 people for a short time, because that seems shallow and, you know, weak to them. And whereas an extrovert says, yeah, but if you just talk to one person, you're missing out on the rest. So they both have an advantage and a disadvantage. So if you're an introverted person, right, drop shy. Forget shy. Never say it again, right? Shy, you're only shy if you say you are. So stop saying it, right? And you can be an introvert. I think in my head. I plan ahead. I like deep, meaningful conversations. Cool.
So now you can network with that. Right? And then the E, the extrovert person, the one who's 100%, if there's 50 people in the room, they're going to meet 48. You probably need to tone down a little bit, right? And I'm 100% extrovert, but if I go to a meeting, like a social, like a networking event, if there's 50 people, I don't talk to 40. I talk to 10, you know, 10, 12. Even being 100% extrovert, you can't just blow through people. You can't meet people for 1 minute, take their card, and then expect anything to happen, right? When I follow up with somebody, I want to be able to talk about some stuff we talked about, that joke that we made, something about their kids, something about their business. So you need to talk to people for at least a few minutes, right? So go to a 90-minute thing, maybe meet 8, 10 people. Yeah, 9 minutes or so each. And it doesn't work out just like that. But some people you might only talk to for a minute because for whatever reason, you just don't get along. That's fine. But somewhere in the middle is a good number. Go to the 90-minute thing, you meet 5, 7, 9 people somewhere in there, low or high. I think that's good. And then the real trick, the thing that people are missing too often, is everything, all the money is in the follow-up, right? Because you don't make any money networking. You don't go networking. Nobody brings their checkbook. They're not there to buy your stuff because you're not there to buy their stuff, right? All the money's in the follow-up. If you want to sell your stuff, follow up with the people you meet. You get a card, send an email, connect with them, give them a call, get together for lunch or coffee, you know, or Mountain Dew. But get together. And again, never pitch these people. The people you meet networking, don't try to sell them your stuff. Find out about them. Find out who are their people. How do they help those people? And then how can you help them, right? How can you connect them with those people? And that is the win in networking. You become the connected center of your community is a thing I like to say. How do you connect with all these people that you've met and really just constantly be putting people together? I had a time, it was a couple months ago now, but in 1 week, I was with a friend of mine 2 different days. And in those 2 different days, he saw me connect 4 different groups of people somehow. So we were like at lunch and I ran into somebody I know, and that guy said, oh, I'm looking for a blah. I said, I know a guy. So I did that 3 days on 3 times in 1 day and 1 time on another day. And my friend was like, my God, it seems like you know everybody. It's like, I don't know everybody, but I'm constantly updating my database in my head and on my computer with people. You know, you need a plumber, you need an electrician, you need a business coach, you need a whatever, a lawyer, you know, personal injury lawyer, you need a will made. I know all these people because my goal in networking is how do I connect you with your person constantly? And so if that's your goal in networking, you'll win the networking game. And, you know, again, networking is a piece of marketing. It's getting people to know your stuff. So I'm telling you to go find out their stuff and help them. And if you help them first, right, there's reciprocity. People will like to help you back. But just, you know, if you are concise and you have your message and you know who your people are and what you do for them, those people that you help will know pretty quickly who you are and what you do. But mostly, they like you as a person and they know your business. Now, I've had people recommend me for web business before, who referred me. I never built a website for them. They might not have even seen anything I did, but they like me so much and they hear me talk about it a lot. They go, oh, well, I recommend, you know, I got referred through them. Somebody sent them to me. Yeah, Toby's great. He does web business. He's a great guy. You'll like him. I'm patting myself on the back here, kind of third party, hypothetically. But they said nice things about me, but they like me enough as a person. They think I'm probably pretty good as a business person, which is nice. So that's how it works. That's the win. You go networking. It's not for you. It's to connect other people. The more people you connect, the better it is for you because then you're the middle of it. So I just love networking. I think it's the best thing. It was kind of funny before I started actually going networking a couple of years ago. I've always been an extrovert and pretty loud and talkative and I'd had a time where my ankles were both really, really bad. And I had surgery. They rebuilt my arches and fixed my ankles. I was on crutches and had cast on either one or both of my legs for about 11 months. And I was really slow going. And I had three little kids, too. It was really hard. So I wasn't getting out very much. And this was a time right when I started to go really networking, just before I started. But even I, being 100% extrovert, was like, I kind of don't want to go networking. Because I had this bad image of what networking looked like. You know, I just thought it was, you know, old business guys in suits with cigars, like a picture of the 1920s, you know, business guy. Well, we're doing business. And it just seemed kind of ugly to me. And I'm like, I'm real fast and loose and, you know, kind of fun. I was like, I'm not going to fit in there. Even I, who love people, made that look some way that was not fun, kind of ugly. So it takes a little bit. You go and you find out, oh, everybody is just some folks and everybody's got their business. And very rarely is there a person there who's pitching, who's really trying to sell you their stuff. And they just don't get it yet. Right. And that's the kind of person they come to the thing and they go, yeah, I'm going to mock an insurance salesman. No offense to any of my insurance salesman friends. But, you know, if you sit with somebody and they're going, you care about the future of your family, don't you? I mean, are you adequately insured? Like, gosh, you know, first of all, terrible sales pitch. But I've actually had somebody give me that whole rap. Like, am I adequately insured? And, you know, can we talk about the policy options? I kind of need policy options, right? I want to know that you, yes, you sell insurance, great. But I want to know that you're a nice guy, that you're going to be there for people, that you're trustworthy, dependable, like all that. And I'm only going to know that by seeing you repeatedly show up. And then I'll hear from clients and I'll hear your stories about clients. And so that's the thing. You're not selling your stuff, right? But, you know, I have an insurance guy or two that I have referred to other people. You know why? Because I've seen him in networking for 8 months. I've talked to him a bunch of times. He seems smart about his business. And he seems to care. He's a good guy. So, I had it a second ago. My friend is John Barry. So, JB Health Solutions, I believe is his name. John Barry's a good guy. Seen him in networking for a year. Real solid. I've referred him a time or two. I'm not sure that he got business out of it or not, but I'm happy to refer him because he shows up. Seems smart, right? So that's the whole thing. You show up, you seem like you know what you do, and that you care. And that's the whole of it. So that's the thing. That's what I want you to do. Go network. And for those of you who haven't been networking yet because you think it looks some way or there's something weird about it, come along with us, right? We're fun. I have a group that meets every Wednesday at 11:30 at Ferg's, which is downtown St. Pete, right by the stadium there. And 11:30 to 1, it's an FNI group, Free Networking International. We usually have about 20 or so people there. And we talk about each other's business, and we get to know each other, and it's real friendly. And the people, like, I can just go out and hang out with anybody after, right? We're all very friendly. And so you maybe get 3 or 5 different new people each time. They show up for a time or two. Maybe they become part of the group. Maybe they don't. All right. So that's a good group. And there's a thing. Ferg's is having he's launching his own networking group. And it starts on Friday. And that's from, I can't say for sure. It starts this Friday, which I believe is tomorrow. And it starts at either 5 or 6, 7 at night. You just look it up, Ferg's. On the internet or on Facebook, he's got a bunch about this thing. I think it's a free event, and you go and maybe meet, I don't know how many people. I'm guaranteed there'll be 50, probably be 100 people or more there. Go find out about other local businesses, meet people. So I live in Tampa, but I go to my St. Pete group every Wednesday, even if I'm not over there. If I don't have a coaching client, if I don't have other work to do, I'll still drive. It's because now I so just like those people, not just for business reasons. And the other thing is, it depends on what a customer's worth to you. Like, what do you sell? If you sell something that's worth a couple of thousand dollars, You only need to get one referral that turns into a sale that makes it worth it for you to go to that networking group forever, right? Because I gotta drive across the bay, and then I'm going to buy lunch. It cost me $10, right? So the whole thing cost me $12 maybe. So do that every single week. But if I sell one piece of work for $2,000, well, I can go all year, right? And now I could just, you know, I don't even need any get any more work. Don't take that. I didn't really say that. I do really need to get to work. Send people my way, right? But so that's the thing. Now, if you're in the business, and you sell a $2 something, you know, get in a different business. I think it's crazy for people who sell $2, $5 things because you need to sell 1,000 of them to make any money at all, right? So go into a higher price business, and no matter what your business is, raise your prices, right? Unless you're a commodity, or apparently the insurance people too, they're stuck on, we have to, I think it's regulated. They all have the same prices. All right. So what did we talk about today? Talk about being really clear in your message, right? Be clear in your message. Who's your target? I cannot ever tell you enough. I'm gonna say it every day. Know who your target market is. What are they up to? Talk in their language. And what are their benefits? I mean, what are the benefits of working with you or using your thing? So then you take that and you go networking. But you're not pitching. You're not pitching your stuff. You're going to find out other people's stuff. The F&I thing has a F&I is a Free Networking International. That's a local group started by David Durgis. And one of the things that we do is there's a two-sided card that asks a bunch of questions that are important, like how'd you get in your business and who's your target market, what geographic areas do you cover, and things like that, which are great. If you can remember 5 or 6 of those, you'll always be able to keep the conversation going, keep it focused on that person, find out about their business. Your job is to find out who's their perfect client. That's your job, right? So find out who that is so that you can refer somebody to them, right? So then you'll be in follow-up. You'll call them later and you go, I got a guy for you. I got a lady who needs your service. And then there's no guarantee, right? You introduce them and you tell them both, I'm not sure how this will work. I hope it works out great, but you seem good and you seem good and you both have the same, you know, you need what he has, so good. But go network. Where else can I do? There's a good meeting every month. Sorry, I just backtracked. Once a month is called the Original Tuesdays. And it might be at originaltuesdays.com, maybe. And they meet at the Hangar, which is also downtown St. Pete, on the third Tuesday of every month, except it's weird this month because of the Grand Prix is happening this month. So that event is actually on the 18th, which is a Monday. And so you can, and again, just Google that. Put that in the Google box, Original Tuesdays, St. Pete, right? And it's like 4 to 8 o'clock. Nobody goes from 4 to 8 except for Al who runs the thing, Al Carnivicious, I think. I don't know how to say his name. He runs Bayprint, and he runs this event, which is really good. So you go from, you know, at any time in between 4 and 8, have a little snack, and meet. I don't know. If I go, I probably see 40, 50 people there at a time. And over a span of 4 hours each month, I mean, he's getting 100 people, 120 people, something like that. So I'd have met some good people. I created a couple partnerships out of it. Might have got a little business. How did I get business? I didn't go sell my stuff. I met somebody. We talked. We followed up. Later, it turns out they needed something, but it's not pushy, right? So another piece, and we're going to be done here in 10 minutes. And I already miss you. I mentioned earlier, if you can share your passion for why you do your business, that would be the best thing that you could do. And share your passion as a story, right? Tell a story of how you got into it or why you decided to go do that now. An example is, I don't remember her name. I think it's Kathy something. Cindy something. Anyway, it doesn't matter. She started Mothers Against Drunk Driving. She was not a public speaker. She wasn't a business person. But her son got killed by a drunk driver, and she thought that was horrible and outrageous. And instead of just being broken about it, instead of crying and whining about it, she went to form this group to support each other and to get enough people into it that they could make a difference. They could lobby. They could get laws changed, and they'd have. So now she's a public speaker, and she's good because of her passion. And she was enrolling, getting other people to join her thing because she would share her story. She would tell people about her son and then what happened and how bad she felt and how nobody would help and whatever that all looked like. And that's how it got to be big, right? Because she then knew her market. She knew who her people were that had that in common. And she created something. So that's it. So what's your story? Why'd you get into doing what you're doing? And even if it's not some life-changing thing, maybe you just picked it. You know, for me, having done web for years and years, I just did it because I learned how, right? I just figured it out and I liked it. But then when I started my own business, my story is, I think I said this before on the show, I picked coaches, authors, speakers. That's who I was building sites for a few years, right? It's opened up now, but coaches, authors, speakers. And it was easy to talk about in networking, and it was easy for people to refer to me because I would say, I work with coaches, authors, and speakers. I work with people who have a message, people who just want to help others, people who are a contribution to the world. Because if I can help that person, that coach, for example, help 100 people, I've helped 101 people. And that's what makes me happy, right? And so the difference is I'm not just some web guy, right? There's 1,000 web guys. But if somebody knows a coach who needs a site, I'm clearly the choice, right? But what if you've heard my stuff and you say, well, I got a friend who's got a liquor store. He's not a coach, author, or speaker, but he needs a website. You still will probably refer him to me, or at least you'll call me and say, hey, I know a guy who's a liquor store. Would you build his website? Right? You think of me because you know I'm in the web world and you know my market, but you also have gotten to know me over time and know that I, you know, do the work I say I'm going to do. I'm the kind of guy who shows up. I'm dependable, blah, blah, blah. It's all very NLP. that you might even ask, and yeah, I can do a website for them. I just can't afford to market to everybody, right? So what makes me happiest to work with this small group, and that's who I'm going to talk about. And yes, you can help anyone. So that's a big deal. And so I don't have a big like life-changing story. I didn't become a web guy, you know, back then because I cared so much about coaches, authors, speakers. My audience kind of found me, or I picked them out of everybody there could be, right? And some folks do websites for musicians. Some people do, you know, websites for doctors' offices only, right? And that's good. But again, if I do coaches, authors, speakers, and that other one does doctors and dentists' office, and you get a dentist who calls you and says, hey, I need a website, you're going to call that other person first, right? Because you know they specialize in that. Right. So if you just know a generalist and me, I'm still in the running too, right? So that's all. It's a lot to talk about, right? I talk very fast. It's enough to fill up an hour, right? So you're gonna market, and then I want you to tell a story about why you got into it or why you do it now. Who are the people you're helping? And again, it's either here's the story of the people I love to work with, or here's the story of, you know, why that is interesting to me. Because it's never, I just want to make money. Anybody who's in the business just to make some money is probably not going to be in that business for all that long because it's not fulfilling enough. It's not deep enough in your body. It's not a big enough why, I think, to get you through those hard times. If things are ugly, you know, things get hard, you'll quit. You'll go, well, I can make money some other way. Right. But if you love those people, you know, you won't quit. You're like, oh, well, I'll figure out how to make it work. I need a health coach to call me and somehow convince me to stop drinking soda. It's my only really bad habit. All right. So and I actually know some. I just don't listen. The other one was I need a strategic planner sort of person to come in and set me up. Right? Say, Toby, you have all these you have no processes for all these things that you do. You need to get organized because clearly I will not organize that myself. Oh, I wanted to mention too, I had mentioned Score earlier, and then the other thing that I have mentioned a time or two was New Urban Suites, which is my where I have my office. And I really love the place. It's cool. The people who work there are cool. There's other, you know, groovy companies that work there. And I just got an announcement. I'm very sad. They're not going to have the business suites. Is that what they call it? No, the business club, which is the kind of the co-work space, which I really enjoy because I can just go there for half a day, a couple days a week, and it's really good. But they're not having that anymore because they sold that whole big room. That whole big space is going to be an office for a new company or an old company, new to me. And so that's not going to be happening anymore, but it's still a cool space if you need an office anywhere near going down by Ybor. But I just wanted to mention it because I mentioned it a couple weeks ago, like, hey, it's a co-work space. You should check it out. But, you know, don't call now because you can't get the co-work space. So that's – but you should get one. And if you know of a good one, you know, you might call me. I'm not sure if I'm going to have a whole full-time office. Yeah. I don't know if that works for me yet. If you do have an idea of a good co-work space, that's cool. I know there's something called Co-work Tampa, I think it is, and they're in West Tampa. And then there's places like Regis, which is, what do you call that? I don't know what they call it. They don't call it co-work spaces, but they have, you can rent an office one day a week kind of a thing, shared workspaces. So that might be good. I do want to mention, before I go, I mentioned it before, but this weekend is the start of the next 5-week improv workshop. And that is, it's called Fun and Fearless, right? I want to teach people how to be ready for any situation. I don't care what's coming up. You can just jump in and do it, right? So let's see, here's a little, oh, I have a mouse that doesn't do what I want it to do.
Brandon, help me.
I've completely broken the entire radio station. So if you look at this webpage, which is tobymartini.com/workshop, that'll get you to it. There's a 5-week workshop, so Fun and Fearless. Like I said, for this, like radio show, I don't know how it's going to look, but I'm just going to go. Now, I'm wiggly here a little bit. I'll get more structure. It'll get better over time, but I can't be afraid to come and do it, right? I just have to go and make it happen. So this workshop is about being bold in the face of anything. It's about being able to talk to anybody at any time, one-to-one, you to a small group, you leading a group, you in front of an audience, right? I get a lot of Toastmasters. Yay, Toastmasters rock. I love the Toastmasters group. Right, people who are speakers who are getting good at formal speeches, at pre-written speeches, but also still need to get better at impromptu. How do I talk off the cuff? How do I answer any kind of a question? So that's the second bit. And then the third bit is just creativity. If you want to be more creative, if you're a creative sort, figuring, oh, how else can I get this out of me? Or maybe you haven't been a creative person and you want to be. You can work with that. And then the last bit is something I talk about all the time, just using your brain differently. How do you remember people's names? Like that'll come up handy in networking. That'll be useful for you all over the place. So that's what we do. It's communications. It's quicker thinking. There's no promise of comedy. Well, let me take it back. It is comedy because it's fun all the time. But I'm not going to teach you to be funny. You know, it's not a stand-up comedy class. It's not improv for go being on stage. But it's be able to always come up with something and never be stuck, right? Like today, I don't know what I was going to say. I just started talking. You might have noticed, right? So how do you do that? Come to this thing. It's 5 weeks. It's fun. It's a little bit like personal development, right? But it's not crying personal development. It's not, oh, when I was 6, my dad, blah, blah. You know, it's not like that. It's how do you be better, stronger, faster, more quick-witted, quick on your feet, able to come up with new ideas fast. And what I tell people sometimes is, you know, you ever been in a conversation and you're just like stuck for a second, or somebody says something and it throws you and you're thrown, you're like, what the? Right? I can help you get through that moment so that you're not thrown so hard that you can't talk anymore. So you don't walk away feeling stupid. You get to keep talking, you get to come up with ideas, and then you work through it. All right. So 5-week workshop, tobymartini.com/workshop. I could use a couple more people. I have a small group right now. I like to have 8 or 10 because then we can do a bunch of group things, give you a little more time to watch. If I only have 4 or 5 people, well, then we're playing all the time. All right. So I am kicking out here, and next week I should have a guest again. And if I don't, I'll have a very nicely prepared program for you, okay? So we are kicking out. For next time, write this down, right? 813-235-0644. I'm going to start taking callers. I'm going to start putting that on my on the Facebook and various places. You can find me. I am on the Facebook, like everybody else in the world. And at Twitter, Toby Martini, at Toby Martini. So that's it for the week. I hope it's been interesting for you. It's been a little wacky for me. And I will see you or hear from you. Maybe you'll see me. I don't know. We'll see you in a week next Thursday. All right. Thanks. Bye.
Thank you for tuning in to TalkWad.com, the world's fastest growing internet radio network. Please check out all the other great shows on www.talkwad.com.